After recent tweets from Rihanna and Greta Thunberg raising concerns with internet shutdowns and farm protests in India, the Indian government was unable to force Twitter to take down accounts of people supporting these protests, including accounts of media organizations like The Caravan. The government of India has now amended intermediary rules of 2011 and brought in new rules called Information Technology Intermediary Guidelines and Digital Media Ethics Code Rules 2021, granting more powers to the government. These rules try to regulate social media platforms, digital publication platforms like Netflix, Amazon Prime, but also have included digital press publications under the Information Technology Act. With these new rules, some publishers have approached Delhi High Court challenging the limited portion of regulating news media under these rules. The new intermediary rules try to regulate any organization with digital presence, but the way the government wants to regulate them can harm the idea of open internet, according to a statement from Mozilla Foundation. In this episode, we spoke to Prashant Sugathan, a lawyer with Software Freedom Law Center, to explain us what these new rules are and why the digital media publishers have approached the court. Welcome, Prashant. Welcome to our Suno India show.
Thanks, Srinivas.
I was hoping you could give us a sense of what these intermediaries are and how are they classified as intermediaries and under what sections of the IT Act, the Information Technology Act, are these intermediary rules even issued?
If you look at the IT Act, intermediaries are defined under Section 2W of the Information Technology Act 2000. So the rules were first notified in 2011, the rules with respect to intermediaries. When you come to the definition of intermediaries, it's a pretty broad definition. And to explain it, I would say that if you take the chain between a person creating content and to the person who finally consumes this content, the entities that come in between to ensure that the content reaches the end user, these are called intermediaries. Thus, platforms hosting the user-generated content like Facebook and YouTube, your telecom service provider like Airtel, the web hosting companies like GoDaddy, online shopping sites like Flipkart and Amazon, all these come under the definition of intermediaries. The definition is so broad that it even includes, say, cyber cafe under the definition of intermediary.
So these intermediary rules were essentially classifying all the business players in the internet ecosystem. So what is the historic context of these rules? I mean, why were these rules brought, right? Like if there is a law that's being brought up, it's usually brought to regulate entities, business entities. Now, in case of these intermediaries, why was the need to bring in these rules happen? And why did so far these rules at some level did not regulate social media at the scale it should probably have?
The Information Technology Act was notified in the year 2000. That was long years before internet became as popular as it is today. Now, at that point of time, there was this website called Bazi.com, which was subsequently taken over by eBay. This was an online auction website, just like eBay is now. And a pornographic clip was uploaded on this website. What happened was the CEO of the website was arrested on his return from the US. Of course, he didn't have any clue about what was going on in this website, who was uploading what or putting what for sale. Now, then there was a request from the various players, various business houses, various persons in the IT industry as such, as to the need for such platforms to have protection from any liability arising out of user-generated content. So to give an example, let's say you post something on Facebook, something defamatory on Facebook. If somebody drags you to court, you could also make Facebook a party. The Facebook also will be held to be liable to it because of some, a concept called secondary liability. Now, the Act was amended in the year 2008 by providing for a safe harbor protection to intermediaries like Facebook and eBay. So all these intermediaries that I explained earlier. This was a, something called a conditional safe harbor. In India, we have a conditional safe harbor where intermediaries get safe harbor protection provided they comply with certain conditions. This is as per Section 79 of the Information Technology Act. Now, what these conditions are, these were notified first in the year 2011 in something called the Intermediaries Guidelines Rules. Now, these rules have now been amended. So the first reason for coming out with this amendment and subsequently the rules were to ensure that intermediaries were given safe harbor protection from any liability arising out of user-generated content.
So essentially, if someone posts hate speech on Facebook or WhatsApp or any threatening speech, Facebook and WhatsApp are not liable so long so they comply with government orders. Now, I believe they're trying to bring in new rules because these rules have kind of become outdated. So they essentially, the new rules are trying to regulate this giant ecosystem of social media at large. But they seem to have added a new set of rules for digital media publications. They call it the Digital Media Ethics Code, I believe. And some of the publishers, some of the digital media publications like The Wire, The News Minute, the founders, the editors of these publications have now approached the Delhi High Court saying that the government's trying to regulate news media publications as intermediaries, and they seem to have an issue with the definition of intermediary and how news publications are being called intermediaries. And at some level, they are saying that this is probably an overreach of these rules because there is, within the parent act of IT Act, there is no provision to regulate press, right? So what do you think about what's happening?
If you look at the definition of intermediaries, as I explained earlier, these are meant to indicate entities who come in between the persons creating content and the end user who is consuming this content. So if you look at these digital news publishers, platforms like The Wire or somebody like a NewsClick, these are the platforms, these are the entities who are creating content. And they can be considered only to be publishers, not intermediaries. So intermediaries are persons who come in between. So by no stretch of imagination can somebody like The Wire be considered to be an intermediary to be regulated under rules meant for controlling or regulating intermediaries. So that is the whole issue with the new legislation, subordinate legislation, that these new rules, where they are trying to regulate publishers who are creating content themselves. Not just for, let's say, digital news publishers, they're also trying to regulate OTT platforms like Netflix and Amazon Prime. So these are all creators of content. And they can never be considered to be an intermediary like Facebook, who are just providing a platform for users to create content and to post it. Now the issue here is that if you look at digital news media, they will have to now comply with the requirements of a three-tier grievance redressal mechanism. This could really pose a regulatory burden for small entities who will now need to have a grievance mechanism in place and to be part of a self-regulatory mechanism, that is a second tier, where a group of entities come together. So there will definitely be associated cost involved with a procedure like that, a mechanism like that. There's also a requirement to publish periodic compliance reports. So this will add to the regulatory burden as far as these entities are concerned. In most cases, these are small entities who won't have the, let's say, the kind of deep pockets that traditional media houses will have. And it will become very difficult for these entities to comply with these rules. So that will in turn have a great impact on free speech in this country and will create a chilling effect where these media houses, where these small entities, will think twice before publishing something because they will have to be worried about, will somebody raise a complaint, grievance about what I'm going to publish? And then maybe cut back on, let's say, these publications so that it is palatable to the vast majority.
So at some level, I would say there could be some, I mean, if I have to look at news intermediaries, right? Like if there could be platforms like WordPress, Blogger, where people could be using their services to run published news, right? They could be considered intermediaries, right?
Of course, somebody like a Blogger or WordPress, these are platforms. These are platforms where you and I could go and post something and get this content published. Yes, that will be an intermediary, but not the person who publishes on those, let's say, blogging platforms. So in fact, when the 2011 rules were notified, the concern was mostly about such websites, such blogging platforms, and the kind of control which could be exercised over these platforms. But now things have changed. It's mostly about platforms like Facebook and Twitter, which are now called the significant social media intermediaries. You are right. As far as you publishing something is concerned, as far as a content creator is concerned, definitely he cannot be considered an intermediary, but a publishing platform like WordPress or a blogger can be considered to be an intermediary.
Great. I think that explains why some of these digital publishing houses are approaching the court to understand, to essentially ask for protections from these rules. But it seems that the government is saying these rules are backed under the Section 69A of the IT Act. What is the Section 69A of the IT Act, and how does this apply to media organizations?
See, Section 69A is often called the blocking provision, which is used to block content. So if any website, for that matter, if the government considers any website to be problematic, the kind of content that it's being transmitted could affect the, let's say, the unity and integrity of the country, and maybe for security reasons and things like that, this content could be blocked by a procedure which is defined in the blocking rules. So that provision is used very rarely. This was used in the case of banning of various apps by the central government. This is also used recently when Twitter was given a direction to block certain handles. So that is the provision which now say they want to use as far as news websites are concerned, news platforms are concerned. So that definitely can be problematic, because these are essentially let's say publishers of content, publishers of news content, current affairs content. And when you try to have a provision like that, if you're going to impose that kind of a provision on these news publishers, that definitely will have an impact on media freedom and free speech. Because you're trying to essentially control what, let's say, news publisher is going to publish on their website. This is like saying, the government will decide what maybe Times of India or the Indian Express would publish. And if they don't like it, in a way they could shut down.
So at some level, when the government has issued these notices to Twitter under Section 69A to block some of these accounts, they also kind of blocked few media accounts. I believe the Caravan India's account was blocked. But the last time I believe something like this happened, where it was taken to the court, was when in Bombay, two citizens were arrested for posting something about Bal Thackeray, and they were arrested under Section 66A of the IT Act. People, I believe, along with a lot of lawyers and civil society, have approached the Supreme Court asking for these sections to be removed, right? Like Section 66A itself was not really constitutional, because these people weren't essentially violating anything except expressing their beliefs over social media. And the court essentially issued an interesting order by striking down Section 66A of the IT Act. And I believe there was also some reading into the intermediary rules of 2011 then. Can you tell us more about what happened then? And I believe these new rules are also trying to overstep some of the orders that were passed in that judgment.
Yes, the Shreya Singhal versus Union of India, that definitely is an important judgment which uphold free speech as far as the citizens of this country are concerned. So that the issue then was definitely with respect to misuse of the provision. The Supreme Court held that the rules are violative of the freedom of speech and liberty, freedom of speech and expression granted to citizens of India under Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution, and also the provision as such was like so broadly worded, so that it could be misused by the law enforcement agencies. And that was one of the reasons for striking down that section, for quashing the section. But along with that, along with the challenge to Section 66A, the information technology guidelines rules, that's the intermediary guidelines rule 2011, were also challenged before the Supreme Court in matters that were tagged along with the Shreya Singhal matter. The Supreme Court finally read down these rules. So the major issue at that point of time was the stipulation in the rules that if somebody complains about content to the intermediary, and if they don't take an action within a period of 36 hours, then they could lose the safe harbor protection. This definitely was problematic and would have led to, let's say, taking down of a lot of content, a lot of lawful content. So this, the Supreme Court held that it can be considered to be an actual knowledge, that the intermediary can consider to have actual knowledge of unlawful content only if there is an order from a court or a direction from an appropriate government authority. So just because Facebook gets a notice from a user, from anybody for that matter, saying that this content is defamatory, they need not take down the content. They need to take it down only if they get an order from a court of laws saying that the content is defamatory, or prima facie defamatory, and then that it needs to be taken down. There could also be a case where you get an order from an appropriate government authority who are authorized to issue such an order, and then the content can be taken down. So this was what happened in this Shreya Singhal judgment. In a few cases challenging the rules, one Mauchat versus Union of India and other IAMAI versus Union of India, which were tagged along with the main Shreya Singhal matter. These were also decided along with it. That was what the court found. Now, one concern is the safe harbor protections which were defined by the judgment and which were the rights of citizens were also protected by the judgment, whether that could be eroded by the new rules. So we will have to really figure out how these rules are going to operate, and only time will tell us whether this will result in eroding the safe harbor provisions granted by the Information Technology Act and also by the Shreya Singhal judgment.
Okay, while that's happening, I believe the current concern for digital media houses is primarily them being regulated under these rules, which is why they are approaching the court. But they believe that there is going to be a larger impact on free speech and press freedom. Because say someone like me or someone like you, a lawyer, is posting their opinions on Twitter, and suddenly a news organization, probably an international news organization or an Indian news organization, uses some of these content, and the government could essentially use some of these provisions asking social media entities to remove some of these tweets, right? Like anything that could come look controversial to them, even though it's not illegal. At large, there is some feeling that these rules and new guidelines are going to be a threat to both free speech and the press freedom. But when we talk about this, there's also the concern of, as you said, which the Supreme Court has upheld, where notices are sent to social media entities and they don't act, which has happened in the case of Twitter now. So how do you see that these issues can be balanced?
See, as far as when social media intermediaries are concerned, definitely there's an issue with these rules and also with the digital news publishers. You're right, in many cases, government can, and they have done in the past also, they have sent requests to these intermediaries to take down content. Now, like what happened in the case of Twitter, orders were issued under Section 69A to take down content and take down a few handles. Now, the problem here is that if they don't comply with these directions, then there could be penal provisions. The concerned personnel who are with these intermediaries could even be arrested. And even the new rules has a provision for having personnels who are based out of India, a chief compliance officer who needs to be based out of India. And these people could be at a risk. These intermediaries push back something. There's an order given by the central government to take down content. Such personnel could be arrested. So that because the new rules mandate that you need to have an office in India and three levels. This is with respect to significant social media intermediaries. There are rules defined. These as any entity, any social media intermediary having more than 50 lakh registered users. So any entity like that needs to have a physical office in India and also three levels of officers who are resident in India. So anything like a pushback happens, we don't comply with an order from the government, then it could, these officers could be at risk and they could even be imprisoned. So definitely this will have a great impact on free speech, where these organizations, these intermediaries will be more than ready to comply with any direction given by the government. Because otherwise, who will risk imprisonment of your employees? And yes, an extension to this is that this definitely will have an impact on free speech as far as the users of these platforms are concerned.
Great. I mean, at some level, I believe some of these social media organizations have floated rules, which is what is forcing the government to act. But at the same time, the rules are so overwhelming that they can't be implemented practically without affecting free speech at large. But it's not just these issues, right? There are other issues that are part of these rules. For example, the regulations of OTT platforms. I believe there was a news article which said Amazon Prime and Netflix are going to drop some of their OTT shows because they're afraid someone might complain about them and they will be risking some of their employees, as you said. So everyone, it seems like every set of online business house, which would be classified as an intermediary, is concerned about these rules, and they're like very, very much self-censoring themselves. That probably the right word I should use. And all of these are happening through rules, right? I mean, the IT Act came in 2000. There were amendments in 2008. I believe now, apparently there are whispers that the parliament is, or rather MeitY, Ministry of Electronics and IT, is trying to amend the IT Act again. But instead of bringing a lot of these through a much larger discussion in the parliament and bringing a law or an amendment, we are doing this through rules. Do you think it's an executive overreach at large? What do you think parliament's role in this should be?
In fact, if you look at the provisions for regulating OTTs and digital news publishers, these have been now done using subordinate legislation without the involvement of the parliament. So this is more like a legislation brought in, by the government without discussions or consultations in the parliament. If you wanted to have, let's say, some sort of control over these platforms, regulate these platforms, then there should have been discussions in the parliament, widespread consultations with the various stakeholders, and then you come with the rule. Maybe amendments to the IT Act if you wanted a regulation. But what has happened now is, instead of any discussions in the parliament, changes in the Parent Act, you've gone ahead and brought forth new rules. So the first question is whether this is an overreach, whether this goes against the IT Act itself. Did the government have powers under the IT Act to come out with such rules to regulate OTT platforms, regulate digital news publishers, which are not even mentioned or talked about in the IT Act? So this definitely is kind of an overreach, where they have gone beyond the powers. The government has gone beyond their powers, which are conferred on them as per the IT Act.
Thanks, Prashant. Do you have any larger concerns within the rules that you want to highlight? I mean, I only know so much from the legal lingo on what the issues at large are, but I do see that there is going to be a larger push towards approaching courts whenever some of these platforms might receive notices under these rules, which they can't implement potentially.
See, there are a lot of issues as far as, let's say, various intermediaries are concerned, various messaging platforms are concerned. But one aspect which has received quite a lot of attention is the one with respect to traceability, where messaging platforms are asked to figure out how to trace the originator of an information. So if there is, let's say, a chain of messages which are forwarded, then the government can, the law enforcement agencies can ask the intermediaries to figure out who the originator of the information is. This could be a problem as far as platforms like WhatsApp and Signal are concerned. Again, if you take a platform like Signal, Signal has less than, let's say, 20 employees across the world. And if you're going to ask somebody like that, this is again run by a non-profit organization. If they have to start an office in India, have, let's say, three level of officers, a chief compliance officer, a nodal officer, a grievance redressal officer, it's impossible for them to operate in India. And then for to figure out who the originator of the information is, it's, and again, it's not just the originator, it's the first originator who is based in India. So for example, if a message chain starts from, let's say, the US, and somebody in India down the chain starts sending it in India, forwarding it in India, the person in India is to be considered to be the originator.
Yeah, I hear you. I mean, at some level, a lot of this is also coming, I believe, because of this whole interactions between Greta Thunberg and Disha Ravi in India, where under which context, the whole Trump protests under which a lot of regulation of social media, asking Twitter to ban any speech of these organizations and people who are involved in. So, and it's all coming back to affecting privacy at large, both in terms of encryption. It's not just speech. I think we will look at talking about what and how these rules are going to affect privacy and encryption in another episode. But thank you for explaining the rules.
Yep. Okay, thanks.
Please rate our podcast and leave a comment if you like it. Underreported and underrepresented stories can become mainstream only if it reaches more people. So please support us by visiting our contributing page on our website, sunoindia.in, or follow us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram.